Praise the Lord, everyone. Today we're talking about love, and Brother Bob Connie was just asking me how much I was enjoying all this heat that him and the Lord have brought us. I told him he could send that order back with a little drier and a little cooler. He was saying he loves the heat. We're going to talk about love today. If you'll stand with me, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Thank him for allowing us to be together, to experience his love. You know what? There's people all over the city who are looking for love. And you may not appreciate or value the amount of love that you've experienced in your life. But if you've ever been filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, you've experienced love beyond what they have yet been able to experience and something they're looking for. Let's thank the Lord for that. Jesus, I thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your word, which teaches us how to love, which shows us the love that you shed for us. I ask you to anoint us today as we study your word. Help it to find good place in our hearts. Help it to grow up into everlasting love. Help love to shoot throughout all of our families, throughout this congregation, and reach out to minister to those who we touch. Ask your blessings upon us today as we study your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord bless you. You may be seated. Thank you for being part of the adult Bible study this morning as we look at the benefits of Christian love, Christian living, and pure love. And Winnie the Pooh says that you don't spell love, you feel love. How many of you have ever been in love before? Hopefully your spouse, you're raising your hand if your spouse is close to you. And then they say that love is blind, but there is a solution for that. Marriage. There was a woman taking an afternoon nap. When she woke up, she told her husband a little deviously, "I just had the wonderful dream that you bought me this beautiful pearl necklace. What do you think it means?" And her husband mysteriously said, "You will know tonight." Oh, man, all day long she couldn't believe it. Couldn't wait, and he walked in with this beautifully wrapped package. Brother Matthewson, you'll love this. She opened it up, and it was a book entitled The Meaning of Dreams. more than one way to fulfill your word. There's many meanings for the word love. And in Scripture, there's four of them that are used. Storge, which is affection, like cousins, I love you. Philia, a friendship, I love you, man. Eros, that romance between a man and a woman. And then agape, that unconditional, the commitment, the sacrificial love of God. In our focus text, 1 John 4:7-21. Beloved, I'm not going to read through all of it, just the highlighted parts. For brevity's sake, we got a lot to get through today. For love is of God. And herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. I can't even love the way that I need to love unless his love's in me. Then I'm just reciprocating a little bit of what he's put in us. Then we ought to love one another. And continuing on with this section, God is love. Not that God has a little bit of love. Not that God will share a little bit of love with you if you're perfect. God is love. Perfect love casteth out fear. If a man say, "I love God," and hateth his brother, he is a liar. That's a hard one to wrap your mind around whenever you have an ought with a brother. But that's Scripture. And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. Pure love allows us to follow God's plan for our lives without fear. Joshua 1:9 says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For your Lord, your God, is with you wherever you go." If you're going into a difficult situation, you're going into a place you're uncertain of, God is with you. Don't fear that. God's love is in you. In your notes, outcome is God's responsibility. Obedience is ours. You may not understand what you end up doing, what's end up happening, but you keep your hand and your life submitted into the hand of God. You're obedient to what he's doing. God will turn that outcome according to the way he wants it to be. And we already know he's looking for our good, that he loves us. We already know there's going to be a good outcome as long as I stay submitted unto my God. My God has this situation. My God loves me. And so it's easy for me to tell people in difficult times, be at peace. God's got this under control. Why? Because I truly believe that if they are doing everything they know to do, God is going to end up blessing. It may not go the way that you want it to go, but God is going to end up bringing good out of it. You know, love, I think it's easy for us as Christians to recognize that love is not understood by secular society in the same way. Not only do relatively few people comprehend the essence of true love, many of them have corrupted and propagated a warped and twisted view of what love really is. These individuals promote a kind of perverted love that seeks self-fulfillment. I'm not really loving in a sacrificial way, that agape way that I'm willing to lay down my life for someone else. I'm looking for what do I get out of this? I'm sure that they're really longing for true love, but really what popular culture and secular singers sing about is lust. It's that carnal desire. Here's what I want for me, not what can I do to end up blessing you. And that's what marriage is built upon. That's what the love of God is it shed abroad. That's what your family is. In your notes, 1 Corinthians 13 is called the love chapter. And Paul wrote it to the believers in Corinthians that love is long-suffering. It's kind without envy. It's not self-seeking. It's unprovoked and without evil thoughts. He goes on to tell us that love doesn't rejoice in iniquity, but it rejoices in truth. Paul said that love is a positive force because it bears all things. It believes all things. And in all things, it exhibits hope and endurance. And then he makes a very plain statement. Love never fails. In short, true and genuine love, it's pure. It's the love of God. Whenever you really love something, there's only one definition of that. It's God. Love. I remember a pastor once asked me to define love. I had just shortly been the working with young marriage or premarital counseling. And I was sitting over here, and Brother Matthewson, I was dumbfounded. I couldn't answer him. How did it end up defining love? And he was looking for a specific answer, and I could tell he was a little annoyed. I didn't even try. I froze up. I couldn't think. How do you define love? It is God working through us. It's a beautiful, it's a miraculous thing, but to define it, it was beyond my ability at that time. 1 John 4 and 8 says, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And then 1 John 4:16 says, and we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Now, we do tend to view love through a very self-centered lens of interpretation. If you don't come up and shake my hand, I may no longer think that you love me. And it may have nothing to do with the fact that you even noticed I was there. It's just you was busy, and I'm looking at you expecting Brother John Jones to shake my hand, and I don't. I'm very self-centered normally. Just as humans, we tend to end up being that. But the love of God isn't quantified by what we perceive him to allow in our lives. Rather, God's love is a matter of unchanging fact. He is love, period. Right. In your notes, loving you, God isn't loving you more when you receive good blessings. And I think that's a trap many of us fall into. That's what we perceive. And he doesn't love us less whenever we're facing a trial. God is love. His love never fails. He may be doing something different in my life than I understand. He certainly may be doing something that I'm not really wanting to happen. But if I truly trust that he loves me and he has my good in mind, if I stay submitted on the potter's wheel, something beautiful is going to end up happening out of that. Jesus died for us when we had nothing to offer him, and certainly we didn't desire such an intervention. Because we was on our way to the results of sin, which is death. But Paul observed these truths in his letters to Rome. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In other words, you hadn't even done something for him, and yet he went ahead and offered this ultimate sacrifice. John 15:13 says, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Then 1 John 3:16, hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. There's a lot of brethren, there's a lot of sisters in here who could ask a lot of things of me. And do I get defensive and say, whoa, my time is way too valuable, I can't be doing that? Oh, I'm offering myself up here for a greater cause. It isn't just for you that I'm sharing that love. It's because I'm showing my love of God whenever I do that. 1 John 4:19 says, we love him because he first loved us. There are some individuals who don't love God, who don't return his love, and they don't seem to care about Jesus' sacrificial death. And for believers, though, it is different. It isn't a matter of there's these don'ts. It's there's unmeasurable love available to me. And once a sinner would recognize what is available to them, their lives change. That's whenever that conviction starts happening, that drawing. And where are they going to feel that love? They're going to feel that as Sister Kenny starts reaching out to them and starts expressing the love of God. And they recognize, you know what? I can tell she's not out to get something from me. She's not befriending me in order to see what she can get. She's just continually pumping out this love of God. They're going to recognize what it is. And eventually they're going to be asking, how can I get some of that? It may not be right now. It may be whenever they get into a more difficult situation. But there, at one point or another, every person comes to that point in their life, I need something. And if you've shown them the true love of God, that is so appealing. It's going to stick in their mind. They're going to come back asking, how do I get closer to Jesus? Romans 12, 1 through 2 says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. As the love of God grows in you, you come to recognize, you know what, I'm not my own. Jesus paid the price for me, so I can offer myself as a sacrifice, and I'm still coming out way ahead. Because as I commit myself to ministry, as I commit myself to doing things for the kingdom, I get blessed in return. How many of you have found that to be the case? I think there's some point in every new believer's life where you've been praying and you felt the anointing of the Holy Ghost in an altar. And you come expecting that. And at some point, it starts to wane a little bit. Not that there's not power here. You just don't feel that same emotion. And it's like a light bulb goes off in your mind when that first time you start to pray with someone else. And that same anointing comes back over. Oh, that's what's happening. God's moved you to a new level. He's taken you past this initial birthing where you've received that, and now you're starting to transmit some of that to other people. That's what that he's talking about here. A living, it's acceptable sacrifice. I'm using my gifts that God's given me, that love that God's given me, to minister to somebody else. Romans 5 and 5 says, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Now, I don't begin to understand or proclaim to understand how love begins or works within a believer. But the Word assures us that His love is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. And the result of God's love changing and influencing believers is that our heart becomes perfected. It becomes pure love that's delivered by the Holy Ghost. It's not me who's sharing it. It's God working in me that ends up becoming that joy and that hope that others recognize. So Spirit-filled believers don't fear judgment, but instead they experience a bold confidence because of their relationship with Christ. Galatians 2:20 says, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but it's Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. God is doing a work in me and through me. I get to participate in some of the greatest work that's ever been done. In Philippians 1 and 1, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, unto the glory and unto the praise of God. You're filled with righteousness that isn't your own. You didn't earn this. You don't deserve it. But God's filled you with the Holy Ghost, and there's a righteousness that's imputed to you. He's given you something that you can share with other people. When we receive the Holy Ghost, we're filled with His Spirit, His righteousness within us. Because Isaiah tells us our own righteousness is like filthy rags. But His righteousness is pure and holy, and it's His righteousness which creates spiritual fruit. And amongst all the characteristics produced within us by the righteousness of Christ, it's a pure heart, absent of fear, with the right motives to express His love. In 1 John 4:18 says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment, and he that feareth is not made perfect in love. I don't know how many of you experienced fear before you came to God. It doesn't mean that we're never going to experience caution or concern over situations in life. And it certainly doesn't mean that we should live carelessly or recklessly. But it means we're not haunted or controlled. We're not terrorized by that immobilizing fear of sin that Satan attempts to immobilize us and intimidate us with. It takes away the effectiveness of a Christian when your mind is just wrapped up in fear. But when the love of God rules in your life, His perfect love, the Scripture tells us, and you can quote it, it casts out fear along with the torment that fear produces. And the love of Christ within us, it gives us freedom to express His love to others who haven't yet experienced salvation. And I become aligned with what God's trying to do in the world. And even individuals who are shy and timid can experience this boldness and this freedom. They recognize the life power the gospel, and they want others to have that same opportunity. We look at the scripture in Acts 4:31, says, and when they prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. There was a power that came. Was it of those people who was in prison? No. It was the power of the Holy Ghost. It was God working in them and using their prayers and their singing. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with a boldness. I don't think it would have referenced that if these men naturally were bold. I think it's telling something supernatural. God enabled them to share the gospel in a bold way. When we receive the Holy Ghost, we become emboldened by the pure power of God. We should experience at least these three dramatic changes that we want to look at today when the Holy Ghost comes upon us. Number one is that we love God more than we ever have before. How many of you remember that first time you just filled with the Holy Ghost? You loved God, but you also loved everybody else around you. Normally, you're hugging people on the altar who you barely know. You're just coming into that conversation with the family of God, but the love of God just flowing through you, and you love everybody you meet. Number two change that happens in our life is we stop loving the sins and the degradation of evil. The scripture calls it the world, and I don't want to confuse that. It's not my friends in the world that I stop loving. I'm continuing to love them. It's that hungering and that thirsting for worldliness of the sin and the degradation of evil, as I mentioned, that it's talking about. And then the third change within us is that we love one another. So let's start looking at the love of God. When we receive the Holy Ghost, we receive His love in a dimension that we haven't ever had before. And we can witness this by studying the life of Peter. Because Peter had the opportunity, before he had the opportunity to receive the Holy Ghost, you'll remember he was quizzed by Jesus regarding his measure of love. The only place and the only person. He was a pretty bold guy, pretty sure of himself. And God kind of put him in this place, didn't he? He asked him those three times, whether, Peter, do you love me? And the dramatic element of this conversation has to do with the measure of Peter's love for him. I don't know that you can read it, but everywhere that they use the word love in this scripture, reading from John 21:15-17, I put in the word agape, or that committed love that Jesus is asking about. And then Peter's response each time was, Jesus would ask, do you agape me? Are you committed? Are you willing to sacrifice your life for me? And Peter would respond, I filio you. I like you as a friend. I respect you, Jesus. He did that twice. And it was the third time that cut to the heart of Peter, because Jesus asked, do you even filio me? Do you even like me as a friend? Because the first two times, whenever he's asking that agape me, give me a moment. It's the supreme measure of love, of respect, and commitment, and devotion. It's more a commitment. And then the word filio is more just of a sense or emotion. We don't condemn Peter, though, for the way that he answered Jesus. Because we read the scriptures. We know it was just a couple hours before that Peter had denied knowing or even being associated with Jesus. A denial which Peter wept bitterly over, and he repented, and God forgave him. And interestingly, we read later on when Peter begins writing his own letters to the church. He's matured at now. He speaks unabashedly of his commitment and his devoted love. And if you look at that in any translation, it uses the Greek word agape. He's fully committed to the gospel. He's fully committed to Jesus. That's specifically from 1 Peter 1:8. And in that same chapter of 1 Peter 1, he speaks of the emotional love for the brethren, as well as the admonition that believers love. And he uses the word agape, one another with a pure heart fervently. Be devoted. Be willing to sacrifice yourself for the brotherhood. When God fills us with the Holy Spirit, only then are we really capable of giving to others that highest measure of commitment. Peter was unable to express such love until he had received the Spirit of God. And when Paul spoke of the love of God being shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost in Romans 5, it's not surprising that he again used the Greek word agape, indicating that the love of God and that highest measure of sacrifice and devotion. Now, there's been many songs and poems written about love. How many of you have ever sang a love song to your spouse or to a girlfriend or a boyfriend? Yeah. I called my wife, Brother Gossmeyer. I guess I've mentioned this here before, so sorry. Telling you. First time I can remember telling the same story twice. I'm following after Bishop. Whenever I was dating my wife, she lives in St. Louis. And, boy, I'm going to forget the name of the song right now. Oh, yeah. I just called to say I love you. Well, she was babysitting, and I couldn't talk to her. She'd already told me that she was going to be tied up, and she had apparently made a commitment not to be on the phone. Very dutiful babysitter, but I decided I was going to surprise her, and I called up on the phone, and I had recorded on a vacation. I'd made a mixtape. How many of you guys made mixtapes? I'd made a mixtape of all these songs running together. I miss you like crazy, miss you. I brought all kinds of songs together, love songs. Well, I was going to play this for her, and I was going to play the part, but the Brad that said, I just called to say I love you. She hung up on it. And so, you know, I didn't know that. I hear her answer, and I put the tape recorder down to the phone, and I let it run for a while. I pick it up. Hello, hello, thank you. I'm going to get, you know, some love back, and instead it's just a dial tone. So I tried it a second time, and finally I figured out, so I didn't put it up there, Brother Ray. And she said, well, I thought you was like some crank caller or a stalker or something. I'm in a strange house. And anyway, many love songs have been written about God and about his love. Many, many hymns have been written, and I like poetry. The dictionary says that poetry is the art of rhythmical composition, written or spoken, for bringing pleasure by beautiful, imaginative, or elevated thoughts. And I'm sure all of you men thought that's what you was writing in your Valentine's cards. If you succeeded, I don't know, but I wish you all the luck in the world. I have a hard time. But the breadth and the wonder of God's love was written about in an ancient Jewish poem called the Hadamut. It was written 1,000 years ago in the 11th century. So fast forward 800 years later when the third stanza of this poem was mysteriously found penciled on the wall of an asylum for the disabled in the early 1800s. And here's what that stanza said. Were the sky of parchment made, a quill each reed, each twig and blade, could we with ink the oceans fill, were every man a scribe of skill, the marvelous story of God's great glory would still remain untold, for he most high the earth and sky created alone of old. How many of you recognize some of those words, or did any of it seem familiar to you? You will in just a minute. Some of you will anyway. An evangelist in the late 1890s finished off his sermon by quoting that scrawled verse. And at the meeting and taking notes was a songwriter, Frederick Lehman. And apparently, Frederick Lehman had saved those notes and the memories of the words he jotted down from the late 1890s. And in 1917, inspired by that third stanza, he wrote two additional verses and a chorus to accompany it. And he called the song The Love of God. And the chorus states, O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and the angels' song. And they're going to play a little clip of it for you from the Collingsworth. If you know it, you're welcome to sing along with it.
Could we with
Do you love the Lord? Whenever you think about it and you stop and think, the psalmist David, as he was writing, what is man that you're even mindful of him? And yet we have the love of the greatest being who spoke the world into being from sky to sky. I just love the whole poem. I love the song. I can't get that song out of my brain. I hope it sticks in all of your brains as much as it did me. It will drive you crazy. I'm going to have to jump through a number of screens here, so give me a moment. I have a lot of stuff we was going to end up covering, but time's just running away, and I was trying to still make it as brief as possible. One of the most amazing lessons on love that Jesus gave was the parable of the prodigal son. And once the son finally came to his senses, was sick of his sin, and ready to change his ways, because that's what repentance is. It isn't saying I'm sorry. Repentance is I'm making a change. Finally, the son was desperate to return to his father. And Luke 15, 17 through 19 says, and when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's had bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Truly, he was returning with a spirit of humility. He wasn't coming back saying, put me right back where I was. Set me up. I'm this great son who left. Because remember, he left with that. Proud and haughty, give me what is mine, I'm going out to do. Yet he returns with this humble spirit, I'm not even worthy to end up coming back. Will you make me a servant? But perhaps the most beautiful aspect of this parable is the perspective of the father. Because the son's father never gave up hope that his son would return. And in fact, on the day that the boy was heading home, the father saw him coming. How could that be unless he was sitting there watching for him, praying, hoping, looking to see as my son come? And he runs from a great distance to see him. The scripture tells us, Luke 15, 20, the father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And further, the father prepared a feast for the return of his son. Nothing can adequately describe the pure, untainted love of the heavenly father, but this is a beautiful picture of that. He loves us so much, the scripture says, he gave his only begotten son. That whosoever believeth in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And the Father's love for humanity was the basis for that incarnation, so that he could redeem us with that sacrificial death. What love! And not only did he give his life to redeem us, but he demonstrated his eternal love for us by allowing us to be called his sons. Every one of us has that opportunity to enter into that fellowship of being the children of God. In the book of Revelations, the Lord directed John to write to the seven churches of Asia. And he told John what to write. And in the first letter written to the angel of the church of Ephesus, God noted many wonderful things that they were doing right. However, the Lord had one thing against them. Do you remember what that was? They had left their first love. That anointing you felt in that altar, that sense of love for everybody around them, it had grown old to them. They just got accustomed to coming and going through the motions. And the scripture says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works. Or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. Except you change. Go back to that first love. The Lord's word for the church at Ephesus and all who find themselves in that condition was to return to Jesus Christ. Return to that first love. The Bible tells us plainly that if we love God, we will keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. Remember that. I like the picture in my mind, because I get that many times from people who are straddling the fence. They see Christianity and the commands of the Word of God as a barrier, as a constriction, something that's holding us in. And I love the analogy. How many of you have ever taken children to a park or to a daycare, and they have a big fence around that, right? Do you see that as a terrible thing, or would you pay extra for them to make it higher? This is protecting my children. This is keeping them safe. See, Brother John Jones, he's agreeing with that sentiment. Electrify that puppy. Keep my kid, well, on the outside. Keep my kids safe here. For whosoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world? But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. In other words, if you want to have a victorious life, get all in. Place your life fully committed to the kingdom of God, because you're going to experience all of these blessings. James in chapter 2 tells us that our faith requires action, because our behavior and our actions demonstrate our faith. It's easy for me to say I believe, but my actions are going to show what my heart truly believes. Keeping the commandments that Christ is giving us demonstrates the sort of love that we have for Him. I'm thankful for the love of God. And joining with Frederick Lehman, O love of God, how rich and how pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure, the saints and the angel song. That's my song, the love of God. I want to share it with everyone that I know. I want you to share it with everyone you know. And you know, as you share the love of God, it draws people close to God, and it draws you even closer to Him. And as you start anointing them, seeing the blessings, letting the Holy Ghost flow through you to them, you receive more blessings. It's a wonderful thing when you live according to the Word of God. Will you stand with me? Let's ask His anointing upon us. Jesus, we thank You for Your love, which we can never fully comprehend, but we do appreciate what we understand so far. Thank You for Your Word, which demonstrates, which shows, which reveals Your love to us. I ask You to anoint Your people today to have that holy boldness that comes from the Holy Ghost and to share that love that You've given us with others. Help us to see the results and be able to testify of it. Ask Your blessings upon the remainder of the service today and upon the refreshments. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Lord bless you.